Hi viewers, welcome to this week's podcast with LERGP. I'm here at the Northeast Lab with Jodi Timer, who's an entomologist with Penn State University. And we've filmed a couple podcasts already talking about the latest invasive spotted lanternfly. And Tim did a great job explaining that it's a phloem eater. There's a quarantine zone in Southeast PA where Jodi's actually been. So I'd really like to get your take on what you saw down there in the quarantine zone.
Down there, we went to two different wineries. One was very well kept, and they were spraying every 2 weeks. And even after spraying every 2 weeks, they had sprayed that day, just 2 weeks later, and the entire netting zone was filled with about 4 inches of spotted lanternfly. All the vines had sooty mold on them. And then we went to see the trap trees. They were systemically poisoning Atlantis Tree of Heaven. And so when they feed on the Atlantis Tree of Heaven, they die. And underneath the trees were about a 2-foot by 6-inch pile, just from one small tree, of dead spotted lanternflies. So they are really feeding in mass on the grapevines. There was probably 100 to 200 on each grapevine in some areas, especially the edge. They come in from the outside like most of the other insects do, so the edge vines get hit the worst, but it was all the way through their vineyards.
So they are feeding on the phloem, they're excreting their honeydew, and that is attracting sooty mold in the vineyards. Is there any indication that what the growers are spraying is actually working?
Yes. Once they spray, there's a lot of dead spotted lanternfly, but okay. They just come back.
They come back from the
forest and from the Tree of Heaven, and they have quite a number of hosts. Almost everything they tested, they will eat. They prefer vines because of the turbo pressure. So they're one of the first invasives we've had that prefer grapevines to a lot of other hosts.
And that's probably what sets them apart from other invasives that we've warned you about, like brown marmorated stink bug or Japanese beetle, is they really attack the phloem. And you might not see it, but the vines over time are really losing their lifeblood.
That's correct. The other insects feed either on the fruit or on the leaves. And if you get rid of them, the next year the vines will come back. These are attacking the actual vines themselves, so after a couple years, the vines will be too weak and the vines will be gone.
And there's been some recent developments and sightings, and one of those was in Virginia, correct?
That's correct. They found, Doug Pfeiffer found a colony, an established colony down there. They checked the age of the colonies from the egg masses. So they feel it's been there at least a year.
Wow. So the egg masses, we actually have a couple examples. So can you take us through, you know, what these are and what surfaces we might see egg masses on?
The egg masses are laid, if you get a picture of this, the eggs are laid and then the adult female lays a covering over them. This is how they overwinter. The adults all die off right after they lay the egg masses. Down in southeastern Pennsylvania, that's happening early November, from late October to mid-November. And so they overwinter like this. It's very hard to see them, but they're all over the end of grape posts. They're all over, they'll lay them on anything, under stones. That's why they, on the end of grape posts too, they lay them. And that's one of the problems, is they're scraping them off the grape posts and any surface they see, but they'll also lay them under stones in the forest, and they like Tree of Heaven, so you would almost have to scout every tree in the woods to get rid of all these, and they're hard to see. They look like mud splatters.
It sounds like in 2018 you're going to be in that quarantine zone a little bit, so why don't we go down and check out the traps that you're building,
okay.
And we'll talk about the research plan for this upcoming growing season. So stay tuned. Welcome back, viewers. We're going to talk with Jodi about what these are and how they're going to be used in the crusade against the spotted lanternfly. So what are we looking at here, Jodi?
We're looking at, we call them cages. It's impossible to isolate a grapevine with spotted lanternfly, but they need to know how many lanternflies are too many. So what we've built here, and we've used them for other insects, is it's a PVC cage you can see inside, and the cross beams work as trellising. So you plant a grapevine in here, you train it up, and then this is special netting developed especially for spotted winged Drosophila. They can't, so nothing can get in here. They stake down the bottoms and they plant the vine in there, and the vine can grow quite a few years inside. Then they just introduce a certain number of spotted lanternfly, either nymphs or adults, and they are hoping to get some idea of how many will completely destroy a vine and how long it takes to destroy the vine and how much sooty mold is produced and when it starts covering the leaves. So we're doing our part up here by making all these cages because we can't bring up the spotted lanternfly into a grape zone. That would be awful.
So who's behind this research objective?
Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture is funding a lot of these projects. They're funding this. Penn State University put in some money also. And most of it is headed up by the Pennsylvania fruit and vegetable and grape team.
So they're going to look at the yields that come from these vines, maybe their vine size measured by either leaf area or pruning weight, and kind of take a look at the impact on the vine of various populations of spotted lanternfly.
Right. The vine health, they're also hoping to get a crop because they're planting 3 to 4 year old vines and testing the wine to see if the spotted lanternfly has any, if any of their compounds are present in the wine because of the possibility of the spotted lanternfly being picked and harvested along with the crop.
Great. So one really important thing would be if you see something, say something, right? So egg masses, being really vigilant about scouting for those, even on things, you know, 55-gallon drums, anything you order that could be from the Pennsylvania area, and making sure you're reporting if you see something. And Jodi's been really generous giving us resources that are available. PA growers and New York growers are being treated a little bit differently. For PA growers, there's a form that you need to fill out and send in. So we'll post that here as well as on our website for you. And as usual, if you have any questions, please leave them in the comments section below, and we'll be happy to address them in future podcasts.